This episode of Real Engineering was brought to you by Skillshare, home to over 16,000 classes that could teach you a new life skill. 2017 was the safest year in aviation history, with zero deaths from commercial passenger jets, and just 44 onboard fatalities attributed to the aviation industry as a whole when military and cargo flights are factored in. Despite ever-increasing demand for flights and the numbers of passengers flying soaring to 4 billion in 2017, the number of crashes has declined dramatically over the decades. Figuring out why crashes have reduced so dramatically, we first have to ask ourselves, why do crashes happen in the first place? Although the number of crashes have continually fallen, the statistical cause of crashes has remained fairly stable, with pilot error, mechanical failure, severe weather, and sabotage being the consistent highest cause of fatalities. Let's dive deeper into the history of aviation to see how the airline industry has adapted to become safer over the past century. Going right back to the early decades of the aviation industry, an era dominated by mailplanes and barnstormers, flying was a hugely risky endeavor. Planes were cheap, and operators valued timely delivery over pilot safety. Not that the competitive daredevil pilots needed much pushing. Plane technology was in its infancy, and crashes were frequent. An airmail pilot during this period had a 1 in 4 chance in meeting their end at the controls of their aircraft. These cowboy days of flight were short-lived with the arrival of increasingly expensive planes, a burgeoning commercial passenger industry, and with the formation of the first pilots' union in 1931, operators were forced to think about reliability, not only for the safety of their passengers and pilots, but to protect their financial interests. Profit was threatened even further after a landmark case in 1936 when the widow of a fallen pilot, Joe Livermore, successfully sued Northwest Airlines for pressuring her husband into flying in dangerous conditions. But overzealous employers could not be blamed for all crashes, even in the case of Joe Livermore. Livermore was an older pilot, which in these days meant you were in your 30s, familiar with the navigation method of contact flying, using visual references on the ground to navigate, which required flying below the clouds, where turbulence and terrain posed a much higher risk. Livermore's Lockheed 10 was equipped with instruments that allowed him to navigate above the clouds using electronic airways, and he was expected to use it. The system used radio beacons that guided the pilots between stations along the intended route. Each beacon would transmit Morse code in alternating 90-degree quadrants. So if you were flying in quadrant A, you would only be able to hear the Morse code for that quadrant. In the next quadrant, the N quadrant, you would hear the mirror image code. And when flying between the two, the signals joined to form a steady tone, which designated the airway. Thus, each beacon was capable of producing four airways. This system relied completely on the pilot's ability to decipher the signal, and static could interfere with the reception. Not only this, but pilots had no way of knowing if they were heading towards a station or away from it. Getting lost with a plane that has limited fuel is obviously not ideal, and passing through cloud cover without certainty of the terrain below was a harrowing experience. And it wasn't unheard of for phantom signals from distant stations skipping through the atmosphere, luring pilots to their deaths either. While this method of flying is vastly safer than flying in the lower atmosphere to avoid pilot error, pilots needed reliable, foolproof equipment that will not lead them astray. Radio navigation is still in use today, but has improved dramatically. Computers now interpret the radio signal and provide a readout on instrumentation such as the Automatic Direction Finder, the oldest radio navigation instrument still in use, which points the pilot in the direction of the tuned station, and autopilot systems are capable of tracking a selected route using this method. Yet even with dramatic improvements, catastrophic incidents were still possible due to pilot error. Take Korean Airlines Flight 007, where the pilots incorrectly programmed the autopilot system, causing the plane to track a straight bearing over Russian airspace, where it was shot down. This event led to further improvements in autopilot interfaces to reduce the chances of pilot error, and was the primary driver for the Ronald Reagan administration opening global positioning satellite access to the world, providing even more redundancy to the tools pilots rely upon to safely complete their job. The importance of reliable instrumentation cannot be overstated. Navigation errors are now a thing of the past, but they are not the only instrumentation that a pilot relies upon. Faulty sensors like pitot tubes, which are these tubes that you can see on the outside of the plane that measure airspeed, can be attributed to several crashes over the past decade. Flying a plane without reliable speed data is incredibly difficult, if not near impossible. the 2009 crash of Air France Flight 447, which killed 228 people, is a perfect example of this. Pitot tubes work simply by measuring the pressure caused by the force of moving air attempting to enter the tube. The faster the plane travels, the higher the pressure, allowing the pitot tube to measure the airspeed very accurately. The pitot tubes of Flight 447 failed as it was flying through the intertropical convergence zone, an area prone to thunderstorms. Here, the pitot tube began to fill with ice, blocking the passage of air to the sensor and thus dropping the air pressure. The aircraft registered a malfunction and turned off the autopilot, giving manual control over to a panicked crew who had no visual horizon in the pitch black of a storm and proceeded to enter the plane into a stall, resulting in a deadly crash into the Atlantic Ocean. It took 2 years to find the black box and discover the exact cause of the crash. Pitot tubes are equipped with drainage holes and heating elements to prevent this kind of problem, but this particular model became overwhelmed with ice before it could be cleared. After this crash, Airbus replaced these flawed pitot tubes and pilots were warned of the problem, which brings us to our next life-saving measure, the Humble Checklist. Just 3 years after this fatal crash, a very similar problem struck a Ryanair flight on approach to Riga Airport through moderate snowfall when the pitot tube heater failed. When speed measurements became erratic and the autopilot switched itself off, the pilots were quick to level off flight at 4,000 feet and begin to work their checklist. Checking each pitot tube output and comparing it with measurements from alternative sensors like the inertial reference system to figure out which sensor was faulty, allowing them to find a reliable readout on the captain's sensors and safely land the plane. The history of aircraft safety is defined by trial and error learning. Accidents by their very nature are caused by unpredicted circumstances, and even our understanding of weather has improved through our obsession with flight. Take the discovery of the microburst weather phenomenon that mysteriously downed multiple planes like Delta Flight 191. Microbursts are characterized by a column of rapidly descending air that spreads out horizontally as it strikes the ground. Microbursts are perhaps the most dangerous of all weather phenomena that threaten planes, with strong, erratic winds. Imagine a plane flying into a microburst. At first, it will experience strong turbulence and a perceived increase in airspeed as the plane encounters a strong headwind, tempting the pilot to reduce power. Next, the plane encounters the incredibly strong downburst of air, which could be enough to down the plane alone. And as it passes through the downward draft, the air direction flips suddenly to a tailwind, resulting in a sudden loss of lift, which would be made even worse if the pilot had indeed reduced power when the headwind was first encountered. These effects combined resulted in Flight 191 hitting the ground a mile short of the runway, killing 134 of the 163 on board and one person on the ground when the downed plane collided with a car. This crash, along with several similar prior crashes, resulted in a 7-year investigation by NASA and the FAA, resulting in the discovery of the microburst phenomenon and the introduction of onboard wind shear radar to detect them. This improvement may never have been possible without the black box, which gave investigators vital data on the airspeeds Flight 191 encountered, helping them piece together an incredibly difficult puzzle. The black box was introduced in 1953 after a string of crashes of the de Havilland Comet, which fell foul of unforeseen stress concentration in the corners of its square windows and fatigue stress from repeated pressurization cycles, leading to the introduction of round windows and a better understanding of fatigue stress. But it also inspired Australian inventor David Warren to provide a tool to help air crash investigators solve their mysteries. It's a simple concept, a heavily protected box that can survive fire, water, and impact. It is perhaps the most valuable tool at our disposal in our quest to minimize the likelihood of future crashes. Yet, even now, the technology is not perfect. Crashes like Malaysian Airlines MH370 remains a mystery as the black box was never found, and it's likely policies will be changed to have flight data continually streamed in real time to ground stations to eliminate the need to locate the flight recorder after a crash. We could be here all day detailing these learning experiences, but that's the core of why flying became radically safer. We are continually learning and preventing repeated mistakes. Systems have continually improved to drastically reduce the chances of human error, the largest contributor to crashes. Systems like fly-by-wire have been developed that prevent pilots from pushing the plane beyond its capabilities. Instruments at the pilots and air traffic control's disposal have improved and been computerized. Engines and flight structures have become vastly more reliable, and our ability to predict and avoid adverse weather has improved, and navigation is now pinpoint accurate thanks to GPS. But these improvements don't explain the radical difference in safety between airlines and countries operating in the same year. the odds of you dying on the top 39 safest airlines is about 1 in 20 million. Reverse that and take the bottom 39 airlines, and your chance is 1 in 2 million, 10 times the likelihood. It's not hard to differentiate between the top airlines and the bottom airlines, the key difference being an airline's ability to maintain older aircraft or buy new ones. Iran exemplifies this problem with 94 airliner accidents in the past decade, resulting in 741 deaths. Much of this can be blamed on sanctions placed on Iran, forcing them to rely on older, unreliable aircraft, which have not benefited from the lessons of the past. The problem is further compounded by a severe lack of replacement parts, preventing vital maintenance work. These problems are so bad that airlines like Iran Asman, which just this year suffered a crash killing all 65 passengers on board, have been banned from flying to Europe. With sanctions lifted, Iran Airlines look poised to buy 180 aircraft from Airbus and Boeing to renew their aging fleet. Updating our technology is our greatest tool in improving aircraft reliability and ensuring the safety of our passengers. Learning is the greatest tool humans possess, which is why I am always happy to work with Skillshare. Skillshare is home to thousands of classes in graphic design, animation, web development, music, photography, video game design, and more. Recently, one of my incredibly stupid friends asked me to shoot his wedding video, and I told him straight up, I am no professional videographer, but I want to do my best for an old friend. So I started watching this course in Skillshare for inspiration, and it's actually just a really good introduction to videography in general. I'm doing this for a friend, but you could easily find a course here to help you develop new marketable skills. These days you can teach yourself pretty much any skill online, and Skillshare is a fantastic place to do it. With professional and understandable classes that follow a clear learning curve, you can dive in and start learning how to do the work you love. A premium membership begins around $10 a month for unlimited access to all courses, but the first 1,000 people to sign up with this link will get their first 2 months for just 99 cents. So ask yourself right now, what skill have you been putting off learning? What project have you been dreaming of completing but you aren't sure if you have the skills to do it? Why not start right now and sign up to Skillshare using the link below? You've nothing to lose and a valuable life skill to gain. As usual, thanks for watching and thank you to all my Patreon supporters. If you'd like to see more from me, the links to my Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram pages are below.